With the modern crop of factory engine management systems, almost exclusively these systems are now using a torque-based tuning process. Now, this can be a little bit hard for some of those tuners that are already familiar with tuning in the aftermarket to adapt to and get their heads around. We're here with Paul from EcuTek to find out a little bit more about torque-based ECUs. So, Paul, before we get into torque-based ECUs, let's actually roll back a little bit and talk about what was around in terms of the tuning strategy prior to that. What were OEs using before torque-based tuning became the norm?
Primarily to adjust the power on a forced induction car, turbo car, in particular, where this is most applicable. It would generally be a boost target that was linked to the throttle position, and there wasn't any integration with, say, ignition and fuel. It was just everything else did what it did, and the boost control was controlled by your right foot.
So essentially, from a tuning perspective, with that strategy, if we want more power and torque, we simply ask for more boost at wide open throttle. The ECU does the rest, yeah. And as long as we keep our fuel and ignition mapping happy, we'll end up with what we ask for?
Yes, pretty much.
Okay, so at what point in terms of a generation, I mean, I know there's not a black and white line in the sand, you know, when did OEs start to move on with their strategies and move to torque-based tuning?
I think in the mid-2000s, we start to see the really the introduction of drive-by-wire throttles, and that's really what started the torque revolution. The primary purpose early on was to be able to vary the power delivery based on the throttle position, or rather the pedal position, to give a different amount of throttle opening for different situations, and then integrate with, for example, torque control for automatic transmission control.
Okay, so when the driver's foot pedal is no longer hard linked to the throttle, because now we've got drive-by-wire, the computer can play a lot of little tricks in terms of depending on what the driver's asking for, what the ECU actually delivers at the throttle body opening, correct?
That's right, and so that introduces torque control in a way that you wouldn't have previously seen on a normally aspirated engine, which gives the manufacturer the facility to smooth the torque application, to control, pick up torque from low speed, control, have a sport mode and an eco mode, as well as all of the feedback into systems like the stability control and the ABS control.
Okay, so there's a few elements there. I mean, in terms of if we're just looking at the outright torque that the engine's delivering, then as we mentioned, I mean, from a tuning perspective, previously we could do this with boost control, but now this gives the OE manufacturers a huge amount more control. And this becomes, at least as I see it, increasingly important as we move away from conventional manual transmissions to the newer generation of automatic transmissions, but specifically DCT or DSG as well. So how does that play in terms of the strategy for a dual clutch transmission to change gear? Why is the torque communication to and from the transmission control module and the engine control module so critical?
There's a few aspects of that. It's most important, I would say, with a forced induction car, because you've also got the additional problem of handling the boost and the turbo control during shifting. From a drivability and reliability point of view, what we're looking to do is smooth out the torque delivery during the shift process. And so there we have all the inertia effects within the transmission that we've got to try and reduce the like the push or surge that you might otherwise get. And then to enable the shift to happen, we have to cut the torque to allow the clutch changeover to occur without trying to introduce the incoming clutch with a higher level of torque, which is going to lead to slip if it's done too soon before we've managed to reduce the sort of slip to below, say, 50 RPM.
The other aspect of this is, while we might not care at wide open throttle about the feel of the shift quality, this becomes really important at part throttle shifts as well. The smoothness of that torque reduction and reintroduction, if that's not done properly, then the person driving it is going to feel that, correct?
Yeah, that's right. So as well as you mentioned, as well as the in between the gears during the shift, then the power reintroduction is all integrated into looking to maintain a smooth, consistent level of torque at the wheels, regardless of what's ever happening in, at the engine, through the transmission, during the shift, and all the other effects from sort of slack in the transmission and so on that can turn up as drivability issues, not necessarily at full load as well, but also, you know, part load, and then you've got takeoff to consider.
All right, so now we've got a bit of an idea of what the torque-based tuning is and why OEs are doing it, or some of the reasons behind it. So from our standpoint in the aftermarket, when we're faced with tuning some of these newer torque-based ECUs, what are the complexities for the tuner, and what tables do we have access to that need to be changed?
So typically it starts with a main torque request. So rather than a pedal position dialing up a kind of boost target that delivers a certain amount of power and is what it is, in this case what we're looking at is a pedal position that delivers a specific number, you know, for torque. You know, often you'll see the calibration will be done in newton meters, and they're looking to deliver a certain torque curve, and that the when you look at, say, for example, the difference between a sport and an eco mode, it becomes quite easy to specify, you know, a low power mode, because you just request less torque. And somewhere else in the ECU, all of those things are taken into account, and the boost and the airflow are calculated and controlled to deliver the torque. But the important bit is the primary request is torque, and not an airflow, not a boost figure or anything else.
So essentially we're asking for a torque value, and then the ECU will decide what combination of boost pressure and throttle position is going to be required in order to deliver what you've asked for?
That's correct, and it's not always the same across all sorts of ECUs. Some will use a combination of adjusting the boost pressure, some will try and run a more static boost and adjust the throttle, so it can vary, but the next step is when you want to increase the power from the stock calibration, it generally will always involve some level of asking for the increase in torque that you're trying to ultimately reach.
Now, the obvious question here is, well, okay, we've got access to this torque table, let's just go in and max out these values, and we're going to get as much torque as the engine can produce. So what's wrong with that strategy?
Well, that sounds good, and to an extent that you will see some sort of gain, but in conjunction with that you're going to run into a whole load of torque limits, and then at the next stage in that, and a very important part of this whole process, is that we'll need to convert the torque request into some sort of airflow or load, and then ultimately a boost request. And so what you'll typically find is that for a given torque request, there'll be a corresponding load level, but that will also be capped. And then to deliver that amount of load, there will be either a calibrated or calculated boost pressure, and that will also be capped. And that might be capped as an absolute pressure. We might also have some limits turn up as a pressure ratio, so you might get some different effects at different altitudes with the same vehicle. From a OE tuning point of view, you usually find that the vehicles are spec'd to be able to deliver their sort of stated standard power at a wide range of altitudes, so there's usually some spare capacity in any given system. So increasing the a number of these limits is also required, sort of in conjunction with any torque request. So
if you don't go in and find and then raise the limits, just physically adjusting the torque request table might not actually allow the ECU to command that.
Yeah. So you might go in and request, say, a 30% increase in torque, and you might get a 10% increase in torque, because then the next you're always subject to the lowest common denominator across all the limits on all the subsystems within the ECU.
So a little bit of detective work might be required to find out what in particular is bringing in these limits, but also a little bit of common sense in terms of understanding the limitations of the mechanical components as well, so that you are working safely and you're going to end up with more torque in a reliable form.
That's right. And what you'll see in the most modern ECUs is that there are safety limits in place for things like exhaust gas temperature, that will limit the torque. There are maybe some limitations on calculated, say, a combustion torque value. And so what you'll see is that each subsystem has its own limit. So there's a limit for pressure ratio, which is really to safeguard the compressor side of the turbo. There might be an absolute limit on boost, which will, which is often similar to pressure ratio, but not always. And that might be designed with some of the induction hardware, maybe the turbo, but also the engine. And then, of course, you've got, you know, engine load, or often expressed as a sort of cylinder fill percentage. And that might be limited because of ultimate, you know, combustion pressure limits. And some ECUs even have, you know, a combustion pressure model that will also limit the load. So when we're trying to increase the power and calibrate these systems, what we at EcuTek try and encourage our tuners to do is really focus on why that limit exists, and not just to max everything out and then sort of cap it on the boost. And there are applications where that might be applicable in some sort of maximum effort drag engine on an OEM ECU. But for the most part, you know, if you have an uprated turbo that still has some physical limitations that you can know about, you can still put those in, and in ideal conditions you'll get maybe your calibrated torque. But in less than ideal conditions, where we have maybe high ambient temperatures, low ambient pressures, high exhaust temperatures, the safety systems can cut in and reduce the boost and load to save the engine.
Yeah, I think in the aftermarket it is very tempting to sort of think we know best and maybe just blanket disregard all of the limiters. And as you say, I mean, the safety systems are there for a reason. So if you can calibrate, get your aim, your target, and still retain those safety parameters, as you mentioned there, they're there to protect the engine and the components in the case of subpar operating conditions like altitude, as you mentioned. So I think, yeah, it's really important for tuners to actually understand what they're looking at and why a particular parameter or limit is there. And then once an understanding has been made, then you can decide what actually needs to be done with it. Look, if people do want to find out more about the EcuTek product, where are they best to do so, Paul?
The best place is on our website, which is www.ecutek.com.
Perfect. Thanks for your time.
Thanks.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.